or in the Viva, you could be asked a bit about this. So the speaker today is Dr. Prachi Mehta, who is at present consultant and lecturer at Nair Hospital. I request her to deliver her lecture. Prachi.
Thank you, Dr. Sripad Pujara sir and the entire fine team for giving me this opportunity. So we would like to. Okay. Can I just share my screen? Is it visible?
Yes,
Okay.
sure.
So as sir already said that this topic is important both in theory as well as practical. It's more of a concept rather than like a entire answer for a question, but then so it's important to understand the concept, then we'll be able to answer it. So what is tone? Tone is, sorry,
Your
so the resistance of a muscle to stretch is referred to as its tone or tonus. It is resistance to passive movement. It is greatest in the anti-gravity muscle. To understand the alpha gamma loop, we need to understand that any reflex arc has certain components. It has a sense organ, an afferent neuron, a synapse, efferent neuron, neuromuscular junction, and finally, effector organ that is a muscle. So, what are the components of this reflex arc in the alpha gamma loop? So, it is spindles and the Golgi tendon organ. The afferent neuron is the 1A to afferent neuron, sensory neuron, and 1B neuron. The synapse is the anterior horn cell and the interneurons, and the efferent neurons are the alpha and the gamma motor neurons, and the effector organ is the muscle. So, just important points about each of these components of the arc, and then we talk about the entire arc. So, what is a motor unit? It is an alpha motor neuron, its axon, and all the muscle fibers that it supplies. They range from 3 to several hundreds. What is anterior motor neurons? They comprise of both alpha motor neurons as well as gamma motor neurons. They give rise to nerve fibers that leave the cord by way of the anterior roots and directly innervate the skeletal muscle fibers. 70% are alpha motor neurons and 30% are gamma motor neurons. Alpha motor neurons give rise to type A alpha motor neurons, which are 14 alpha motor nerve fibers, which are 14 micrometers in diameter. These fibers, they branch many times after they enter the muscle and innervate the large skeletal muscle fibers. Gamma motor neurons, they are smaller than the alpha motor neurons. They give rise to smaller types of gamma motor nerve fibers, which are 5 micrometers in diameter, and they supply special skeletal muscle fibers called as intrafusal fibers. And they are the main fibers which constitute the middle of the muscle spindle, which helps control the basic muscle tone. So what is a stretch reflex? When a skeletal muscle with an intact nerve supply is stretched, it contracts. And this response is called the stretch reflex or the myotactic reflex. So here we can see in this diagram that there is the receptor, that is the muscle spindle, and the green color is this afferent of this loop, which is the 1A fiber, which enters the dorsal horn and enters the anterior horn directly on the anterior motor neuron. And from there, the alpha motor neuron, which arises and supplies the motor end plate, is activated. So this is a monosynaptic loop. Now, this also, here we can see in green are the gamma motor neurons. They give an inherent tone to the muscle by directly affecting the muscle spindle. 1B are the fibers which arise from the Golgi tendon organ, and this Golgi tendon organ supplies the anterior motor. In the anterior horn, it supplies the interneurons, which are inhibitory on the alpha motor neuron. So, after the muscle is stretched, if it reaches an extensive level, then the Golgi tendon organ is activated, which is actually an inhibitory reflex. So, we will understand in detail each of these loops. The central part is the acontractile part of the muscle spindle, which does not have actin and myosin. It only has an efferent activity, and the peripheral ends have actin, myosin, and they are innervated by the gamma motor neuron. So we'll understand in detail each of these receptors. So sensory receptors, they provide information about the functional status of each muscle to spinal cord. The muscles and their tendons are supplied abundantly with two special types of sensory receptors, the muscle spindles and the Golgi tendon organ. So muscles, what are these muscle spindles? They are distributed throughout the belly of the muscle. They send information to the nervous system about muscle length or rate of change of length. And the Golgi tendon organ are located in the muscle tendons and transmit information about the tendon tension or the rate of change of tension. So it's important to understand that the muscle length is by the muscle spindles and the tendon tension is by the Golgi tendon organs. And the signals from these two receptors are either entirely or almost entirely for the purpose of intrinsic muscle control, and they operate at a subconscious level. How are these muscle spindles activated? So first is by muscle stretch, simple lengthening of the muscle. This causes the middle portion of the spindle also to stretch, and it causes increase in the afferent discharge and hence the activation of the alpha motor of the alpha gamma loop. Now, if the length of the entire muscle does not change and only the contraction of the end portions of the spindle's intrafusal fibers are activated, this also stretches the middle portion of the spindle and excites the receptor. So by both these mechanisms, the muscle spindle can get activated. But this is how you can draw the diagram of a muscle spindle, showing the extrafusal fibers, the intrafusal fibers, the extrafusal fibers, which are innervated by the alpha motor neuron, the intrafusal fibers, which are innervated by the gamma motor neuron. These are the efferents, and the afferent is the 1A and the 2. Sensory nerves. So this is a further detailed diagram of the spindle showing the nuclear bag and the nuclear chain fibers. The nuclear bag fiber has afferent supply by 1A, and the nuclear chain fiber has afferent supply by both 1A and 2 fibers. The efferent supply to both is by the gamma fiber, gamma motor neuron. But important to know is that the dynamic gamma motor neuron supplies only the bag fibers, whereas the static gamma motor neuron supplies both the bag as well as the chain fibers. Now, what these dynamic and static fibers do and how they help in control of muscle tone, we'll see. This is how you can draw a diagram of the Golgi tendon organ. So this, the green part is the tendon and the muscle fibers that you can see. Each Golgi tendon organ is connected to 3 to 25 muscle tendons. And this is extensively innervated by the organ of Golgi. So this is how a Golgi tendon organ. This is a diagram which I have made just to make you understand the concept. So when this is the, on the lower down, we can see this muscle state, that is at the baseline, on the unstretched stage and the stretched state of the muscle, and when you further stretch it to a very extensive level. And on the y-axis, we can see the firing rate of the muscle spindles. So these are just for representational purposes so that you understand the concept. These are not absolute values. So when the muscle is at a particular baseline, it is innervated by the gamma motor neurons, and that gives it a tone. And this tone is sensed by the afferent firing rate of the spindle. So if at a baseline, the spindles are firing at a rate of 6, and if the muscle is unstretched, the firing rate decreases and it, say, comes down to 4, the muscle gets relaxed. But if the same muscle is stretched, then the firing rate from the spindles increases, and it's, say, for example, it comes to 12, then the muscle contracts due to the stretch reflex. Now, if the same muscle is made to lengthen or stretch even more, then there is activation of the Golgi tendon organ, and it activates the inverse stretch reflex, and immediately the muscle is relaxed. So the whole aim is to maintain the muscle length, to prevent the muscle from overstretching. That is why we have muscle spindles and the entire reflex, stretch reflex arc. So because the spindle is in parallel with the extrafusal fibers, when the muscle is passively stretched, the spindles are also stretched, referred to as loading the spindle, and this initiates the reflex contraction of the extrafusal fibers in the muscle. So you can draw this one. This is a very simplistic diagram. This is a monosynaptic pathway. The afferent is the sensory nerve. It synapses in the anterior motor the alpha motor neuron in the anterior horn, and this is the motor nerve which activates the extrafusal fibers. As we already discussed, if it reaches to a very to an excessive state, and if still the stretch is excessive, then the tension is great enough and the contraction suddenly ceases. And this ceasing of contraction is done by the Golgi tendon organ via the inverse stretch reflex. So how does this inverse stretch reflex work and the stretch reflex work? So this is a diagram from Genong. So here we can see the spindle. When the muscle is stretched, the 1A from sensory 1A fibers from the muscle spindle are activated, and they activate the alpha motor neuron in the anterior horn cell, and hence the extrafusal fibers are activated. And when the excessive tension is present, then directly the Golgi tendon organ is activated, and 1B fibers, they activate the interneurons, which are inhibitory. And the inhibitory neurotransmitter in this inverse stretch reflex is glycine, and in the stretch reflex, it is the activating neurotransmitter is glutamate. So via this inhibitory neurotransmitter, there is inhibition of the alpha motor neuron. Also, with this point, there is reciprocal innervation. That is, when a stretch reflex occurs, the opposing muscles relax due to reciprocal innervation. Impulses in the 1A fibers from the muscle spindles of the protagonist muscle causes postsynaptic inhibition of the motor neurons to the antagonists. And a collateral from each 1A fiber passes in the cord to an inhibitory motor neuron that synapses on a motor neuron supplying the antagonistic muscle. So here it is important to know that, for example, when you are either passively extending the knee joint or you are checking the knee jerk via a reflex hammer, what happens is that after the muscle spindle is activated, a signal also goes to the inhibitory interneuron, which inhibits the flexor motor neuron, and it activates the extensor motor neuron. So this is how is the reciprocal inhibition. So we already discussed about the static and dynamic motor neurons, gamma motor neurons. So what is the action of this dynamic stretch reflex and static stretch reflex? So the dynamic stretch reflex is over within a fraction of a second after the muscle has been stretched to its new length, and static stretch reflex continues for a prolonged period thereafter. And this reflex is elicited by continuous static receptor signals transmitted by both the primary and secondary endings. So when first the muscle is stretched, it is the dynamic stretch reflex, and then to maintain the stretch, we have the static stretch reflex. So this is how we get a damping of the reflex. And in cases where there is hypertonicity, we get this kind of an ectatic stretch reflex, where the damping is affected. Then there is a concept called as alpha gamma coactivation. So in response to descending excitatory input to the spinal motor circuits, both the alpha and gamma motor neurons are activated. Because of this alpha gamma coactivation, intrafusal and extrafusal fibers, they shorten together, and the spindle afferent activity can occur throughout the period of the muscle contraction. In this way, the spindle remains capable of responding to stretch and reflexively adjusting the alpha motor neuron discharge. So when the descending fibers, they give a signal to the anterior horn cell, not only the alpha but also the gamma motor neuron, both of them are simultaneously activated, and gamma motor neuron, it kinds of balances the stretch we've already discussed by which loop. And this is how we have the supracortic, the upper motor neuron control of the reflex arc. So this upper motor neuron control is very important, because different lesions at different sites, we know they cause decerebrate rigidity, decorticate rigidity. So entire concept revolves around how we are controlling this reflex arc. So the stretch, the alpha gamma loop, the stretch reflex, it is controlled by the descending long tracts. For example, the corticospinal tract, rubrospinal tract, vestibulospinal tract, reticulospinal tract. And at each level, so this is a different concept which you need not write in this answer, but you also need to know about it. For example, the corticospinal tract and the rubrospinal tract, they innervate the distal muscles mainly. And the reticulospinal tract, vestibulospinal tract, they innervate the proximal muscles. And in that also, we have the flexor muscle innervation and the extensor muscle innervation. Also, when patients are very anxious, you can get a very brisk knee jerk. So this is again based on the descending control of the alpha gamma loop. So this was about the loop, and my references were Guyton, Ganong, and De Jong. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prachi. Very nice. That was quite, to the point. Thank you very much. You tried to make this basic science slightly difficult appearing subject. You tried to make it easy. Thank you. Let's go on to the second lecture for the day. And that is on, as I said, Pathophysiology of Diabetic Neuropathy by Dr. Kishore Shetty, who is a consultant neurologist with special interest in neuromuscular disorders, who is practicing in Mumbai. Dr. Shetty, please.
Thank you. So let me start. I'll be talking on the pathophysiology of diabetic neuropathy. For your theory exam, I think it's important to remember only the main headline. So I will talk a little bit about the details so that you remember the main sections of the diabetic neuropathy pathophysiology. So my outline will be an introduction. Talk about the peripheral nerve circulation, polyvalve pathway, advanced glycation end products, oxidative stress, pro-inflammatory processes, and the cellular and trophic factors. So diabetic neuropathy is one of the most common neuropathy. Even in diabetes, it is extremely common. So even in the first year, about 7% will have diabetic neuropathy. And by 25 years, almost 50% of patients with diabetes will have neuropathy. And if you do electrophysiological studies, almost 90% will have some neuropathic abnormalities. It is a microvascular complication of diabetes, unlike a macrovascular complication like MI, stroke, etc. The risk factors are, one is the duration of diabetes. Second is the control of sugars, the HbA1c. Third, other risk factors are hyperlipidemia, especially low HDL, high triglycerides, hypertension, and smoking. The DCCT trial showed that reduction of HbA1c by about 2% reduced the risk of diabetic neuropathy from 12% to 5%. There is a 60% reduction in neuropathy. So control of sugars reduces the incidence of neuropathy. First, we'll talk about peripheral nerve circulation. Most of the nerve biopsies showed that there is a microangiopathy of the endothelial circulation. So this is, like I said, a microvascular complication of diabetes. So there are microvascular changes. The blood vessels show hyalinization of the basal lamina and the lumen reduction. So there is reduction in nerve blood flow, and there is autonomic dysfunction and endothelial edema. So there is decrease in VGF, nerve growth factor, angiopoietins, etc. So the microangiopathy, as it progresses, it correlates with the nerve fiber loss. So there is a microangiopathy which causes nerve fiber loss, but this is not always the primary cause. Microangiopathy is one of the pathophysiologies of diabetic neuropathy. So in addition, in skin biopsy, you may see loss of nerve endings, which can be evaluated by the punch skin biopsy. So before going on to the various metabolic factors, the metabolism in nerves is controlled by the glycolysis and fatty acid oxidation. Glucose metabolism leads to production of NADH, and fatty acid oxidation leads to FADH. These go to the mitochondria. In the mitochondria, there is ATP production via oxidative phosphorylation. And oxidative phosphorylation causes reactive oxygen species production. So this is the basic metabolism. So let's see what happens in diabetic neuropathy. So the central pathophysiology of diabetic neuropathy is the polyol pathway, which has been most extensively investigated and researched. So when there is hyperglycemia, the excess glucose gets metabolized by glycolysis and the tricyclic by the TC pathway. It may get metabolized by the polyol pathway, where the aldose reductase is the rate limiting enzyme. And hyperglycemia leads to formation of sorbitol via aldose reductase with depletion of with oxidation of NADPH to NADP. So this is important because there is depletion of NADPH. Then sorbitol gets converted to fructose by sorbitol dehydrogenase with the reduction of NADH, NAD to NADH. So earlier it was thought that accumulation of sorbitol causes osmotic stress. But this is not the main cause of diabetic neuropathy, because in neuropathies, in animal models, they found that the levels of sorbitol was not that high. The sorbitol causing osmotic stress is a pathophysiology for diabetic cataract or diabetic development of cataract, but not the main reason for neuropathy. So there have been more studies, and we'll talk about it. But it is seen that if there are more transgenic mice models, if they overexpress the aldose reductase, they will develop neuropathy even when they are fed galactose and not glucose. So even when they are fed galactose, they develop peripheral neuropathy similar to diabetes. So if it is not osmotic stress, then what else can happen? So there are two other mechanisms. One is poor energy utilization. So with accumulation of sorbitol, there is deficiency of myo-inositol. So because osmolites get adjusted, so myo-inositol gets deficient. Because of it, there is deficiency of phosphatidylinositol, and finally leading to reduced ATP production, and finally causing reduced sodium potassium ATPase activity. This is another theory that because of accumulation of sorbitol, there is defective energy utilization. The third mechanism is depletion of NADPH, like the NADPH is oxidized to NADP. So this causes glutathione deficiency, and glutathione deficiency and nitric oxide deficiency leads to oxidative stress. So because glutathione is required to convert the reactive oxygen species to less harmful metabolites, so deficiency of glutathione is thought to be one of the main causes of the main effects of the polyol pathway. Then the other thing was like myo-inositol deficiency causing reduced ATP and reduced sodium potassium ATPase activity. So the important thing is that the polyol pathway leads to a deficiency of glutathione and oxidative stress. So polyol pathway has also been found to be important in ischemia. So in ischemia and reperfusion, there is activation of polyol which causes more tissue injury. So aldose reductase inhibitors was found to be preventive for ischemic injury also. So it elevated lesions in functions of the brain, heart, kidney, retina. And there have been various molecules which have been studied as inhibitors of aldose reductase. But apalristat, this showed improvement in early neuropathy. It showed improvement in patients who had mild neuropathy and patients who had very early neuropathy. There it prevented worsening of diabetic neuropathy. But otherwise it was not effective in all people of diabetic neuropathy. So in mice models where there was streptozocin is a drug which induces neuropathy in mice models. In mice models, when there is streptozocin induced neuropathy, these mice develop neuropathy. If they have aldose reductase overexpression through transgenic models, then they will develop more severe neuropathy because of increased sorbitol, reduced in sodium potassium ATPase, reduced protein kinase. Those transgenic mice which have less aldose reductase, then they are protective of this. Okay, then the next mechanism is advanced glycation end products. So advanced glycation end products will cause neuropathy, will cause various metabolic abnormalities, not just neuropathy. It's even important in dementia. So each component of the nerve tissues can be glycated. So glycation is an irreversible non-enzymatic process whereby proteins get glycated. There is auto-oxidation of glucose which produces various molecules like glyoxal, methyl glyoxal, and carboxymethyl lysine. So these then bind to various proteins and cause dysfunction. One of the mechanisms is that when the advanced glycated end products are formed, they bind to receptors for advanced glycation end products. So AGE binds to RAGE, and then RAGE causes various subcellular activity. So yeah, I'll talk about it later. It can cause like this different levels of abnormality. Like in the Schwann cells, they will cause abnormal transcription of nuclear factor kappa B. In the axons, they can bind to axonal proteins and cause impairment of axonal transport. It can also bind to the basement membrane and cause vascular changes as well as impairment of regeneration of the nerves. So this we'll skip because it's quite complicated. So, see, the advanced glycation end products will can also even so again in animal models. So these animals who were given advanced glycation end products developed changes similar to diabetic neuropathy, even if they didn't have diabetes. So the model mouse models which were given AG, they developed neuropathy. The mechanism is that they bind to RAGE and lead to abnormal nuclear transcription of nuclear NFKB. And this leads to abnormal gene expression. This gene expression can cause apoptosis as well as release of inflammatory product. Two molecules which inhibit advanced glycation end products, one is aminoguanidine and benfotiamine, but they have not been successful in human trials. But in mouse models, they help in the neuropathy. It improves the endothelial blood flow and myelin structure. So both the polyol pathway and the advanced glycation end products cause oxidative stress. They lead to free radical production, and free radical production is the major pathology. So if you come to oxidative stress, now oxidative stress is there in pathophysiology of almost all disorders, including anterior horn cell. So you can probably write about oxidative stress very easily. Oxidative stress cause leads to free radical production, mitochondrial dysfunction, and apoptosis. So there are other causes of oxidative stress also, like cholesterol gets oxidized to oxysterols, LDL gets oxidized to oxidized LDL, and which binds to oxidized LDL receptors and toll-like receptors and causes further nerve dysfunction. One of the mechanisms by which alpha lipoic acid acts is that it reduces free radical stress and improves nerve conduction and blood flow, even in clinical trials. So there is in this protein kinase activity. Protein kinase is a sort of very important for nerve function, and there is abnormal protein kinase C activation in the nerve. So there is reduced protein kinase C alpha in the endothelium and increased protein kinase C beta form in the epineural bladder cells. So protein kinase C beta inhibitors have been tried in neuropathy. So protein kinase C alpha activity is reduced, and protein kinase C beta activity is increased in the pathophysiology of diabetic neuropathy. One of the molecules, ruboxytorin, inhibits protein kinase C beta, and it has been found beneficial in mouse models. So there are pro-inflammatory processes, like there is activation of cyclooxygenase pathway, and cyclooxygenase deficient mice do not develop severe neuropathy. Then there are multiple other pro-inflammatory processes, or whatever you can remember, you can write. So the macrophages produce increased TNF-alpha, MAP kinase, interleukins. These have been found to be reduced by N-acetylcysteine and pioglitazone. There is increased activation of, like I said, nuclear factor kappa B, which leads to excess transcription of various proteins, leading to either cell survival or apoptosis. There is increased activity in the hexosamine pathway and glycolysis. So there are, now next we'll come to the cellular and trophic factors. There is a lack of neurotrophins in diabetic neuropathy, which prevents axonal regeneration. Insulin functions as a neurotrophic factor. So in very small doses, where it doesn't control the sugar, insulin is a neurotrophic factor for nerves. Deficiency of insulin will prevent this neurotrophic action. Then the main neurotrophic factor is the nerve growth factor. So the decreased production of nerve growth factor in the skin is seen in diabetic neuropathy. And when you supplement nerve growth factor, there is amelioration of small fiber autonomic neuropathy in the animal models. But the clinical trials of nerve growth factor was not successful, because maybe it was not, it was given as infusion, but it was not effective, because probably it was not delivered in the right manner. There are other neurotrophic factors like neurotrophin, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. BDNF has a role in central sensitization. Then ciliary neurotrophic factor, etc. So this is a common pathophysiology combined. So like hyperglycemia leading to advanced glycation end products, oxidized LDL, then the polyol pathway, all causing reactive oxygen species, and mitochondrial dysfunction leading to apoptosis and nerve dysfunction. Overall, it leads to cellular damage as well as vascular, microvascular damage. So this is the pathophysiology of diabetic neuropathy. The references were these. So you will not find much detail in your books, but you will have to refer to specific articles if you want to read about more details of AGE and the polyol pathway. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Shetty. So it was very thorough, although you covered everything in such a short time. Very nice. So for all PGs, just to reiterate, so sorbitol, polyol, oxidative inflammatory, so many points need to be discussed in such a simple question, and kindly remember all of them and make sure that your answer is more complete. So let's go into our third. This is now more clinical lecture, very important, especially as times are advancing and with more diagnosis of cancer and cancer therapies, we are seeing more and more of these cases. The topic is sensory ganglionopathies. Will be delivered by Dr. Subhashree, who is an additional professor at NIMHANS, and I request her to deliver her lecture. Subhashree.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the organizers for this opportunity. So I'll be talking about sensory ganglionopathy. The synopsis of the talk will be, this will be the synopsis where I'll be covering the neuroanatomy, the causes, clinical features, investigations, treatment, and prognosis. A brief word on the neuroanatomy. So a sensory ganglion is a collection of cell bodies of neurons, and they lie alongside the spinal cord appended to the dorsal root of each of the spinal nerve. And because they are containing the sensory nerve fibers, so they are primarily sensory, and they harbor sensory pseudo-unipolar neurons. So they contain both large fibers and small fibers. The large fibers carry the proprioceptive and tactile sensation, and the small fibers carry the thermal and nociceptive sensation through the spinothalamic tracts. Now, what makes them more susceptible to antibody and immune attack is because they are covered by fenestrated capillaries and they lose the blood nerve barrier. So that is one important reason why the dorsal root ganglion is more susceptible to immune and toxic injuries. So sensory ganglionopathy or sensory neuronopathy, so it's a disorder characterized by damage and dysfunction of the sensory neuronal cell bodies and the trigeminal ganglion sensory neurons. So they have both proximal projections, which are the sensory nerve roots which enter the spinal cord, and they have the peripheral projections, which are the sensory fibers running to the peripheral nerves. Generally, they are considered to be rare disorders, and underdiagnosis is always a problem. So even if you extensively evaluate them, even up to highly 50% of the cases may still be idiopathic. And the other frequent causes will be paraneoplastic and immune-mediated, like the Sjögren syndrome. So what will be the clinical presentation? So you may get this as a short note, or you may get a case. If there is a classical case, you may also get it for a clinical case presentation. So the presentation can be acute or subacute. And there is proximal sensory symptoms and asymmetric sensory symptoms. So how they present is, they may come up with the asymmetric sensory symptoms in the upper limb. They may have sensory symptoms in the face, trunk, or in the body or perioral region. So they may have sensory symptoms which is patchy, asymmetric, not length dependent. And that will be associated with a gross and a early involvement of sensory ataxia. And when you look at the muscle strength, it is generally normal. So though they have significant incoordination, if you check the muscle power, that will be normal. And over and above, they may have positive and negative sensory symptoms. Often there may be involvement of trigeminal involvement, the Gasserian ganglion. And when small fibers are involved, they may also have autonomic dysfunction. Then when you check the sensation, there will be loss of touch, vibration, proprioception, and sometimes pseudoarthritoid posturing, and Romberg's test will be positive. So this is just to show how they differ from other symmetric polyneuropathy and mononeuritis multiplex. They may have patchy asymmetric sensory loss, the pattern of sensory loss. And they may have generalized areflexia. And when the small fiber ganglions are involved, dysautonomia ranging from orthostatic hypotension, cardiac arrhythmia, adeus pupil, these may be seen. And sometimes based upon the inherited classical signs like orange tonsils in Tangiers or angiokeratomas in Fabry's, these are all inherited causes of neuronopathies. These may be accompanying clinical features. So the first and foremost to propose this criteria was by Asbury and Brown, but this was not validated. Subsequently, in 2009, this was the criteria that was proposed, and there was a scoring system for it, which has clinical and electrophysiological features, basically based upon the asymmetrical sensory loss, upper limb sensory loss, or attenuated upper limb snaps, and relatively preserved motor conduction studies. So based on this, there is a scoring, and the causes may vary. As I mentioned earlier, up to 50% can still be idiopathic, and the other potential causes includes inflammatory. The important one among that is Sjögren syndrome, infective, and then paraneoplastic, which can be commonly associated with small cell lung cancer. Then medications, cisplatin, oxaliplatin, doxorubicin, and excess of vitamin B6 and other hereditary causes. And this is the investigatory battery, which generally is advocated. So in all the cases, sensory and motor nerve conduction study, and then CSF study. Then for specific causes, paraneoplastic testing, including anti-HU, anti-CRMP5, anti-AMP5-SYN antibodies. Then in relevant cases, PET CT. Then testing for Sjögren, including RO-LA, ANA, Schirmer, and lip biopsy. And then vitamin level assessment, then in selected cases, skin biopsy. So this is the panel of investigations which is used for evaluating sensory ganglionopathies. And CSF, as I mentioned, so this may show elevated proteins and mild pleocytosis, or it can be totally normal. And when you get into the conductions, the motor conductions are normal generally. And with regards to the sensory nerve conduction studies, it's the SNAPs which are reduced. And there is pairing of the sensory latencies and conduction velocities. And this snap reduction may be asymmetric or generalized depending upon the clinical pattern. And generally when the snaps are absent in the arms or and they are preserved in the lower limbs, then you know then that you are dealing with a non-length dependent pattern, which is characteristic of sensory ganglionopathy. And associated sometimes when they have small fiber ganglioneuropathy, autonomic dysfunction can be brought about by the autonomic nerve testing, and somatosensory evoked potentials can also help. Blink reflexes, they can also provide additional information when there is involvement of the Caesarian ganglion, and this gives you a clue to the etiology, because it is more commonly involved in non-paraneoplastic cases. And MRI, if you get, there are certain specific sequences which are suggested, like the multiple echo data image combination or turbo inversion. So some sequences are specifically advocated for DRG imaging, and even DTI, they are proposed to be more more representative of sensory neuronopathies compared to axonopathies. So these are the MRI signal changes. So it may show the middle picture is showing the diffuse signal change in a patient of neuronopathy with Sjögren syndrome. And the third one, which shows only the gracile tract involvement in AIDS associated neuronopathy. MRI can give a clue. Then with regards to biopsy, DRG excision biopsy is rarely recommended. It is not done as a routine. And sensory nerve biopsy, when we do, apart from the loss of large and small fiber nerves, we will see that there is absence of clusters of small regenerative fibers. So this feature is because the cell body is per se damaged. And then skin biopsy can also help us to differentiate from sensory axonopathy. So here there will be a non-length dependent pattern of intraepidermal nerve fiber density reduction. So that can also help us to, so these are selected cases. These are not routinely done, but these may give additional clues. So this is the overall picture, the clinical clinical pattern, the investigations. Now, when we go into specific causes, say, for example, the paraneoplastic, which is also called as the malignant inflammatory sensory polyganglionopathy. So here, this neuronopathy may antedate the diagnosis of cancer from months to years. And in 80 to 85% of the cases of these paraneoplastic, they may be associated with anti-HU antibodies. So routine CT imaging, not just the X-ray chest, a CT imaging is recommended. And the most common underlying neoplasm is small cell carcinoma of the lungs. But the other cancers may be breast, ovary, prostate, gastric, lymphoma, and others. And what gives a clue? When there is involvement of, when there is pain, when there is autonomic features, and when there is other, apart from the PNS, when there is a CNS involvement. So these all may give additional clue to the cause of paraneoplastic sensory neuropathy. And when paraneoplastic neuropathy is suspected, one has to have the entire panel, including the anti-HU, CRMP, amphiphysin, ANA type 3 and type 2. So all these should be done. And as I mentioned, CT should be done. If not, one should go for the PET imaging. And the prognosis is guarded. It's not very great. Apart from treating the cancer, there are some immunomodulatory therapy that is proposed, but the results are often disappointing. And with regards to the immune mediated, we saw the paraneoplastic. Under the Sjögren's, under autoimmune, we have the Sjögren's syndrome. So here, additional involvement, when the trigeminal ganglion is involved, there will be facial and peripheral numbness. Dysautonomic features can be seen. And 5 to 15% of Sjögren's may have polyneuropathy, of which 40% may be large fiber and 20% may be small fiber sensory neuronopathies. So if there is a classical Sjögren case with sensory neuronopathy, we might encounter that in a clinical case presentation. So one should know what are all the battery of investigations you look for, and the ANA, the anti-nuclear antibodies, the Schirmer's, which may be positive in more than 90% of those with sensory neuronopathy, lip biopsy, which may be positive in more than 90%. The MRI may show dorsal column T2 signal changes. And there are known criteria for diagnosing Sjögren syndrome. And treatment here again, apart from steroids, there's a plethora of drugs which are used, the plasma exchange, the infliximab, rituximab, and with variable rates of success. And then there are other autoimmune causes like the celiac disease, where you will find other additional findings, like there may be associated peripheral neuropathy, cerebellar ataxia. And here it is the initiation of gluten-free diet, which may help in these set of patients. And this is one of the novel finding where people have found in up to 19% of idiopathic sensory neuropathies, anti-fibroblast growth factor receptor 3 antibodies. So this is one of the novel findings which may aid in the diagnosis of sensory neuropathies. Then toxins, so asking history of toxin exposure, so high dose pyridoxine, cisplatin, doxorubicin, this also will help in the diagnosis of sensory neuropathies. And so this has to be high dose, which is like 250 to 3000 milligram per day. So pyridoxine use should always be inquired in all patients with sensory neuropathy. And cisplatin, carboplatin, here even after stopping the drug for as early as 4 months after the drug has been stopped. So that is called as coasting effect. So that can, the neuropathy can still evolve and may progress for up to 6 months. So asking this history is also very important. There may be associated autonomic symptoms and ototoxicity. Toxins in a cumulative dose more than 250 mg per meter squared, that can also cause dose-related ganglionopathy. Thalidomide, so this is one of the drugs which is commonly used in the cancer chemotherapeutics. This can also cause a painful sensory neuropathy. Along with that, there can be palm erythema and brittle nails, and this is also dose-related. And apart from this, despite of investigating the entire panel of paraneoplastic autoimmune, one may still end up with an idiopathic sensory neuropathy, which is more common in females and which will have a chronic indolent course, apart from the classical findings. And hereditary neuropathies, there's a list of big lists, which can be starting from hereditary sensory autonomic neuropathy, Fabry, Tangiers, and then the Pol G mutations, the CANVAS, the facial onset sensory motor neuropathies. So these all are the causes of inherited sensory ganglionopathies. So the approach, this is the approach. So when someone presents, when sensory neuropathy is suspected, electrodiagnosis and clinical examination, and then supportive findings of MRI and CSF. And then in those with the chemotherapy exposure, that could be chemotherapy related. And then you run the entire panel of paraneoplastic, including paraneoplastic antibodies, CT chest, and then PET to look in for paraneoplastic. And if there is no, if there are Zika symptoms, one goes for lip biopsy. And then if it is HIV or Sjogren related. So this is the entire panel. And then if nothing turns out, then it is labeled as idiopathic sensory neuropathies. And the differentials includes the ataxic neuropathies, sensory ataxic neuropathies, the chronic demyelinating MAG or antisulfatide neuropathies. So these are all the differential diagnoses, and we will be able to differentiate them mainly by the pattern of clinical evolution of the symptoms, the clinical signs, the asymmetric pattern, generalized areflexia, motor power being normal, and gross and early involvement of sensory ataxia, the presence of sensory ataxia. These may all give a clue to differentiate from these other neuropathy types. And the treatment ranges from variety of immunotherapies, as I mentioned earlier, and treating the underlying cancer, which may not really improve the disease per se, but may at least halt the progression. So this is the approach for the ganglionopathies. We looked into the clinical patterns, the electrophysiological findings, MRI, investigatory battery, and the list of investigations and the treatment. And overall, the prognosis is not very great. They don't improve very well. And but proper and adequate early diagnosis is important to at least halt the progression. And these are the review articles and Bradley reference. Any questions or comments or any suggestions?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. Subhashree. I think you covered so much in just around 18 minutes. That was very thorough. And this presentation will be very useful to the PGs after we share it. Thank you, I think Dr. Pratik Bapat is a PG who wanted to ask something, but let's finish this last lecture and we will let him speak. Let's do our last lecture for the day today. And as you know, this is on recent advances and what is new in the pathogenesis of motor neuron disease. And it will be current views on the, on the etiology of motor neuron disease, which will be delivered by Dr. Rajesh Beni, who is a consultant at Fortis Hospital. He also is one of the most dynamic fine trustees, the youngest of all of us, and he has been extremely actively involved in all most of the teaching sessions we have been running. So Rajesh, off to you for this important topic.
Hey, thanks, Shripad, for that wonderful introduction. Can you see the slide?
Yes, we can.
So I was really surprised that this actually came as a short note, because this is such an obscure and a very small part of the topics which you read during your exams, but all the more important that you should know given the current thrust on various pathogenesis of neurodegenerative disease. So obviously you start your answer with general types, that what are the motor neuron disease subtypes. And here you should be careful not to confuse it with other diseases which involve the anterior horn cell, like the genetic ones, purely genetic ones, which is the spinomuscular atrophy, the Kennedy disease. And you restrict your answer to the MND subtypes, where if you have a predominantly upper motor neuron involvement, it is PLS, the lower motor neuron variant, which is called progressive muscular atrophy. And obviously, if you have a combination of two, it is the Charcot's amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Now, most of the research which has been done is based upon the research which is done on ALS pathogenesis. And researchers believe that probably PLS and PMA may have some pathogenetic factors which may be similar to that seen in ALS. So when you look at amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, majority of it is sporadic and only 10% of them are familial ALS. And these can be either autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive. However, majority of the research that we see in pathogenesis of ALS is in this small subset of 10% of patients. And researchers believe that the recent data suggests that even the similar mechanisms may be operating in those with sporadic ALS. And when we go through this lecture, we will realize that there are various, but they are probably interconnected mechanisms which are operating in leading to this neurodegenerative condition involving both the upper and the lower motor neurons. So before we go on to specific pathology and pathogenesis, let's see about some genetic abnormalities which are commonly seen in patients with the amyotrophic lateral sclerosis type of MND. So the most common type of mutation which has been observed is the copper or the zinc superoxide dismutase type 1 mutation, most commonly known as SOD1 mutation, which is the most common cause of familial ALS. It is seen in up to 20% of these patients, but it is also seen in those with sporadic ALS in about 0.7 to 2%. The second most common mutation that you see is mutation of the FUS protein, which is a protein which is very important for mRNA function, for the splicing function and incorporating into the cytoplasm. And this is the second most common genetic abnormality after the SOD1 in those with familial ALS. Phenotypically, they are different from the SOD1 mutation patients because they tend to be younger. They will have more frequent bulb involvement and they are much more rapid as compared to those with the SOD1 mutation. C9 open reading frame 72 hexanucleotide repeat expansion is the most common genetic abnormality found in sporadic ALS. It is seen in up to 5 to 7% of patients. And we know that these patients tend to be young and they may have associated frontotemporal dementia. So a lot of genetic abnormalities have been described and also abnormalities of the alsin protein. There are abnormalities of the vesicle-associated membrane protein, VAPB. And the most important one is this TDP43 mutation, which we'll look at it in some detail because they form the most important component of this ubiquitin inclusions, which are seen in patients with ALS. And also there are certain two proteins which are associated with Paget's disease. The one is optineuron, where there is hereditary glaucoma, Paget's disease and ALS, and abnormality of the VCP gene, where you see a combination of Paget's disease, myopathy, frontotemporal dementia, and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. So various gene abnormalities. So obviously the pathogenesis of ALS is not a single point, but there are multiple gene abnormalities. Probably there are a lot of extrinsic factors which are working, and all these ultimately lead to degeneration. So before we go on to the theories that have been proposed for the pathogenesis for ALS, we will look at certain pathology of patients with ALS. So how the degeneration actually starts in ALS is really unknown, but the researchers now believe that it probably resembles a programmed cell death. So some apoptotic signal starts, causes dysfunction of the mitochondria, and that leads on to a cascade, which leads to a programmed cell death-like feature. It probably starts simultaneously in the upper motor neuron and lower motor neuron. The site of maximum involvement will actually demonstrate the clinical phenotype. So if it's purely upper motor neuron, it will look like your PLS. Purely lower motor neuron, it will start as PMA. And if it's a combination of two, it will look like an ALS to you clinically. So like I said, there are various but simultaneously operating hypotheses which have been postulated. But when you look at them neuropathologically, for all patients with sporadic ALS, and most of those with familial ALS, the neuropathological molecular signature is the presence of ubiquitinated inclusions, mostly containing TDP43 immunoreactive neuronal cytoplasmic inclusions. So different genetic abnormalities, different pathogenic hypothesis, but this seems to be the core in most of those with ALS. So what are the inclusion bodies that we see in patients with ALS? Like I said, UBIs are the most common inclusions in ALS, both in the upper motor neuron as well as in the lower motor neurons. TDP43 is the major component of these ubiquitinated inclusions, but it does have other components like the FUS protein, Budina bodies, which are predominantly localized to the lower motor neurons, and hyaline conglomerate inclusions, which are predominantly seen in the upper motor neuron. Now, these are tongue teasers, and I think you will have to remember them, but FUS and TDP43 keep coming even in the FTD patients. So these are important things to even remember for your VIVAs. Now, as research is advancing, Brack, who actually is fascinated by how the pathology progresses, like what he has done in patients with Parkinson's disease, he's also proposed a four-stage model of amyotrophic lateral sclerosis based upon the accumulation of TDP43 in various brain cells. So in stage one, there is initial formation of this TDP, phosphorylated TDP43, especially in the motor neurons of the bed cells in the cortex, in the brainstem cranial nuclei, and in the low motor neurons of the spinal cord, especially in lamina 9. As the disease progresses, it goes to stage 2, where the middle frontal gyrus, some part of the prefrontal cortex start getting involved. As it goes to stage 3, you start getting involvement of the basal ganglia, rest of the prefrontal cortex. And by as soon as the patient starts reaching stage 4, you start seeing involvement of the cells even in the hippocampus. So this is based upon the accumulation of TDP-43 in various brain structures. So probably it goes through various phases. But low motor neuron cells are involved very early in patients with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. That's the reason why clinically you may not find obviously something abnormal with them, but histopathologically or even on EMG testing, you may find low motor neuron symptoms early, even in those with seemingly upper motor neuron presentation. So among the most popular of the theories, the theory which is most widely talked about is that related to oxidative stress. And this has been classically studied in those with SOD1 gene mutation. And SOD1 gene mutation actually leads to a toxic gain of function. The primary function of SOD1 is to behave as an antioxidant metalloenzyme. And its primary function is to catalyze the conversion of toxic superoxide radicals to innocuous oxygen and hydrogen peroxide. Now, in the presence of mutation of SOD1, this function is lost and there is increased free radical formation, there is inhibition of proteasome activity, there is mitochondrial damage, and ultimately formation of intracellular aggregates, which is supposedly an early event in amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. So oxidative stress is very important for probably initiating the abnormalities that you see in patients with ALS. Oxidative stress also deprives the motor neurons of tropic factors, which also probably propagates destruction of the glial cells, inflammation, and subsequent fibrosis. Excitotoxicity is a favorite theory in causative for patients with ALS. And this also forms the basis of the use of the drug riluzole, which is a drug which prevents the release of glutamate. So the excitatory toxicity theory of ALS says that there is an increase in glutamate, or probably there is a lack of the astrocyte glutamate transporter, excitatory amino acid 2 protein. So what happens is that as soon as the impulse reaches the nerve ending, there is an excess release of glutamate, and which is coupled by inactivity of this EAAT2 transporter protein. So a lot of glutamate is available to stimulate the AMPA receptor postsynaptically. This leads to influx of calcium into the postsynaptic neuron. There is damage to the mitochondria, and ultimately this triggers a cascade which leads to apoptosis and programmed cell death. So oxidative stress, excitotoxicity, and mitochondrial dysfunction form the core of the abnormality which you see in patients with ALS, and probably all of them are intermingled. So what happens in those who have SOD1 mutation is there is incorporation of this abnormal SOD1 mutation in the matrix of the mitochondria. So this leads to abnormality of mitochondria function. There is abnormal protein finding in the mitochondria, which causes abnormality of the electron transport abnormality. Because of this abnormality of the electron transport chain abnormality, there is less formation of ATP. There is less efficiency of the sodium potassium ATPase. There is less efficiency of the calcium channel pumps. And hence, there is a loss of calcium homeostasis. As we all know, mitochondria is a very important cell organelle, which is important for maintaining the calcium homeostasis within the cytoplasm. So what happens in patients with SOD1 mutation, there is efflux of excess calcium from the mitochondria to the cytoplasm. This calcium then stimulates cytochrome C. Cytochrome C is a very important signal which then goes on and triggers a group of enzymes which are called caspase enzymes. And these are enzymes which are actually responsible for leading to the programmed cell death or apoptosis. Because of this calcium abnormality, there is also increased formation of reactive oxygen species, and it also makes the cell more vulnerable to glutamate toxicity. So see how they are linked together. And it is also found that patients with ALS are also deficient in two calcium binding proteins, that is calbindin and paralbumin. And because these are deficient, these patients tend to have more of calcium toxicity. Now, to unify all this, to look at the role of other genetic proteins which have been found in patients with ALS, these are new theories. The newest among them is the abnormality of RNA metabolism. And this is exemplified by the abnormality of two RNA processing proteins, that is TDP43 and FUS, and presence of their abnormal aggregates in the dysfunctional motor neurons. So it has been now found that these are probably not epiphenomena, and they are also causative in triggering many of the abnormalities that you see in patients with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, of which TDP43 is a very important one because it forms the core of most of the ubiquitin aggregates that you see in patients with ALS. It is a nuclear protein which is expressed in almost all tissues. It is important for regulating mRNA processing process in various forms like splicing, translation, and gene transcription. The other important function of TDP43 is to protect the mitochondrial function. So because of abnormality of this TDP43, there is abnormality of mitochondria. Because of oxidative stress and glutamate toxicity, there is abnormality of mitochondria. There is increased release of calcium, cytochrome C, and then activation of programmed cell death. So it is not only these cell organelles, but also abnormality of axonal transport abnormality, which leads to the pathological changes that you see in patients with ALS. Neurofilaments are cytoskeletal proteins that confer structure and shape to the motor neurons, and they are actively involved in axonal transport. And one of the other pathological abnormality that you see in ALS is accumulation of this NFS in most of the histopathology tissues. Abnormalities in axonal transport then cause secondary abnormality of mitochondria. There is resultant mitochondrial accumulation, which are morphologically abnormal. There are deficit in energy production. There is accumulation of reactive oxygen species, release of proapoptotic agents, and ultimately triggers the activation of cytochrome C and programmed cell death. There are other theories which have looked at other supporting structures in the neurons, which can lead to the abnormalities that you see in ALS. So it has been found that only the presence of SOD1 mutation in the neurons is not enough to explain the changes that you see in ALS. But there are also changes in the astrocytes and the microglia. And most of this astrocyte and microglia dysfunction is because of inflammatory neurotoxicity. So in patients, they have found that there is abnormality of CD4, there are abnormalities of CD8, and probably SOD1 mutation also causes influx of a lot of inflammatory cells in these patients, and especially pro-inflammatory cytokines, prostaglandin E2, which leads to secondary neurotoxicity of the astrocytes and microglia. Now, it is because of this inflammatory theory and also the antioxidant theory that minocycline at one point of time was used in trials with patients with ALS. It was useful in animal studies. However, in certain human studies, it actually tended to aggravate or accelerate the disease process. So it has been disproved now and it is not being used. But this was one of the mechanisms where minocycline was actually touted to be useful. And obviously, we have seen that all these ultimately mechanisms lead to an inappropriate activation of the caspase enzymes, which leads to programmed cell death. And this seems to be exemplified or enhanced in those with SOD1 mutation. So to conclude, most patients with ALS, especially the sporadic and majority of the familial, will have ubiquitinated inclusions. Mostly they are TDP43 immunoreactive cytoplasmic inclusions. Most of the studies which have been researched are those with familial ALS. However, probably similar mechanisms are also seen in sporadic cases. There are multiple theories, yet simultaneously operating mechanisms which can lead to ALS, like the excitotoxicity theory, mitochondrial, oxidative stress, RNA metabolism abnormality, and obviously pro-inflammatory and programmed cell death enhancement in those with SOD1 mutation. So multiple theories, probably a unified mechanism doesn't exist, and this answer probably may form a scaffold for most of the degenerative conditions, because all these mechanisms are operating in most of the degenerative conditions. I thank you all for a patient listening.
Superb, Dr. Benny. That was excellent lecture. See, so I would like to sort of emphasize how he made use of the known mechanisms in certain familial ALS and TDP43 in the first, and then take that as the initial data to to expand the answer and then bring on all the basic molecular mechanisms into the answer. I think superb. I really enjoyed this lecture. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Benny. I think one of the student, Pratik Bapat, had raised his hand and he wanted to ask something. Manasi? Manasi? I don't know how to include that.
Yes, sir. Just a moment. Just give me a moment.
Sure. So is he there still in the audience? Apart from that, I don't see any questions, but it was a very useful session.
No, sir. Dr. Bapat is not in the session, right?
Okay, no problem. Thank you very much. I thank all my speakers for preparing these topics. And as Dr. Benny said, some of them were really tough to, you know, prepare. And probably Benny must have had to read a lot and dug through articles. But I thank him again and thank all my speakers and Subhashree for such a long answer made very easy and short. And Prachi and Kishore as well. Thank you very much. Thanks for the session. Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Thank you.
Night.